To the glory of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. It's Epiphany. It's the time of the church year following Christmas when we acknowledge that Jesus is God. Last week, our scriptural readings told us that we should see Jesus as God, and so many references to sight and vision, vision of the heart, vision of the mind, vision of the soul, vision of the eyes, that we should see him as God. But this week, it's a different text. It's to see him as God through our ears, to hear that he is God. For as we see now, we hear, we continue with all the manifold ways that we can know that Jesus is God, and to do that. All four of our readings talk about Jesus as God. The Old Testament reading opens up with God the Father speaking. But interestingly, the first reference to voice is one that says he will not cry aloud or lift up his voice. God is speaking about the Son. He is speaking about Jesus, the one who would go to slaughter, the one who would go to the cross. And in that one instance, he would not raise his voice, but would dutifully lay himself down for us. But throughout the rest of these readings, what do we have but God speaking aloud? The psalmist in Psalm 29 says, "The voice of the Lord is great upon the waters. The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. It's a voice of splendor. It breaks the cedar trees. It splits the flames of fire. It shakes the wilderness. The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe." And then we go on to Peter's explanation in the Acts reading that Luke presents us, and it says, "Peter opened his mouth and said," and he goes on to give this magnificent explanation that we'll talk about in a minute, of the things we need to have in our hearts as we leave here today to be assured of things. And then in the gospel, we have the great concluding crescendo where God the Father speaking through the heavens with a thundering voice that comes down. And he says, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." It's a bookend, if you will, because you're hearing that today on this first Sunday of the Epiphany. And you're going to hear it on the last Sunday of the Epiphany again at the Transfiguration. The Epiphany is bookended by the voice of God thundering from the heavens telling us, "That's my Son. I am well pleased in him." Now, this idea of God thundering and listening to him is important because sometimes it's a thundering voice and sometimes it's a small, still whisper. Like I say so often, people say, "Speak up, Lord, I can't hear you." He said, "You get calm and quiet and listen to my whisper." And he says something that helps us that we have to really be still to get. One author wrote that you have to be near him to hear him. I like that. You have to be near him to hear him. You need to be close to the Lord. Draw in. Listen carefully. Another author wrote that the Bible is the voice of God in print. I like that too. I want to hear God's voice. I don't hear a voice. I've never heard a voice in my life. I don't hear voices like that. I pray God would speak to me. That'd be exciting. He never has yet. But I know that in print in the Bible, I can hear his voice constantly. And in today's reading, we have all these things. Now, we talk about thundering voices. This morning, BJ said, "What'd you do yesterday?" And in telling him what I did yesterday, I came up with this sermon illustration that really helps understand what's going on here and how God can really break through the ordinary. I was on Georgia Avenue in Aspen Hill up the road at an auto parts store. I needed some auto parts, so I went up there. While I was there, I got out of my car, and I'm starting to go in when I hear a sound. It was a strange, eerie sound, like nothing I've quite heard before, but then again, like some things I've heard before. And it was in the distance, and it was waning, whining, if you will. It was bellowing. It was plaintive in some cases, like begging or asking for something, lamenting in some ways. And it got a little louder, but it went on for minutes. Now, all the other people around me are stopping. They're watching, too. I started to think, has there been a disaster? Is it like 20 ambulances at the same time, but why don't they ever stop? What's going on? I thought, is it an air raid siren of some kind? Is that what's going on? I thought, maybe that's what it is. Now, you know me, thinking the way I think. I know what it is. It's the trumpets of the angels. Jesus is coming back. This is it right now. It's going to happen right here in this parking lot. I'm going to meet Jesus. A few minutes later, finally, a hearse at 5 miles an hour comes slowly up across the shopping center where I was and starts moving across. Behind the hearse, 25, 30, 35 tractor-trailer trucks without their trailers, just the tractor, blowing their horns at the top of their lungs, their air horns, as loudly as they could, no doubt signaling their honor of their comrade who was in that hearse before them. And then after the trailer trucks came the cars of all the funeral mourners on their way to the cemetery. And suddenly what I thought was the bizarre had become the beautiful. They were using the voice of the air horns of their trucks to speak aloud the mourning and the loss in their hearts, but yet their glory in their friend who went down. I began to wonder. I wondered, do they know the voice of God the way they're speaking their voice through their air horns? Do they understand that their comrade there has not gone to a cold, dead grave? If his faith is in Christ, there's hope for him way beyond. This voice of God speaks to us in those ways. And then I remember things about graves and voices, and things started coming together. Does anybody here know who Mel Blanc was?
Mel Blanc?
Yeah, there you go. I see Susan's hand go real fast. He's the voice of Bugs Bunny, Tweety Bird, Sylvester the Cat, Elmer Fudd, I mean, Foghorn Leghorn, Barney Rubble on Flintstones. He's called the Man of a Thousand Voices. Now, I bring him up, not just to make a reference to voice, but because of this. I remember reading that on his tombstone, it says, "That's all, folks." Just like in the Looney Tunes cartoons at the end, where quirky people go, "That's all, folks," right? And do like that. But the proof of Jesus as God in Epiphany, whether we hear it or see it or otherwise absorb it in our hearts, defies that statement, "That's all, folks." Peter, in his magnificent explication in the Acts reading today, you need to track the Acts reading with me. Pull it out, take a look at it as I go through this. He's telling us, this is not all, folks. It's not "that's all, folks." It is much more than that. There's much more coming, and we have to hold that. He's telling us these things because we need to understand that when Peter speaks in the Bible, it's the Bible, it's eternal, it is. But you and I can speak of eternal things too. Our voices can be used for God's purposes, so God can speak through us to people who need to know hope, people who are hurting, people who are lost, people who believe that's all, folks, when they go to a grave or when someone they love goes to the grave. And that's not all, folks. There's an eternity in Christ to be lived, and the hope and joy of living this life, and the knowledge of that, so we don't have the fear of it. We need not to be afraid of death or anything else, because we've conquered that through Jesus Christ. Peter began to speak to them, says the Acts reading today. In other words, Peter's voice opened up. I believe God was channeling through Peter, inspiring Peter what to say. And we get this magnificent, all-inclusive gospel in a nutshell. What Peter's about to say to us through this voice is so important for us to know. It's not as encapsulated as that nutshell reading from John 3:16, where we have that gorgeous saying that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the end of all that believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. There's the great gospel in a nutshell. Peter kicks it a different way. And he opens up in a way that blesses me. And why does it bless me? There was a time in my life where I thought I wasn't included with God. I was a bad guy. I was a guilty person. I was a sinner. I'm somebody who didn't have any faith for 20 years of my life. So I didn't feel like I belonged, and that was for somebody else. But Peter says here, "I truly understand that God shows no partiality, none whatsoever, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." Anyone. I am included. You're included. Everybody in the world's included. No wonder we should raise our voice and speak what we heard from the voice of God and tell everybody, good news, this is for you too. This billion-dollar lottery of eternal salvation is for you as well as for me and for everybody, even the worst of them. John Newton, who wrote The Amazing Grace hymn, he became an Anglican priest, was a slave trader. He lived an abominable, horrible life before he became a Christian person. And he lamented that. He thought things were horrible for him. And then the amazing grace that came upon him inspired the hymn. But he also wrote these sentences. Listen to what he wrote about having grace available to him and to all of us. He said, "When I get to heaven, I shall see three wonders there." Three wonders. "The first wonder will be to see many people there whom I never expected to see." Most of you guys. "The second wonder will be, I will miss many people who I did expect to see who didn't get there. But the third and the greatest wonder of all will be to find myself there." That is a gorgeous truth of our salvation, that we are going to be there, all of us who hold Christ in our hearts. And he says, not only is this something for you to have this pie-in-the-sky mansion over the hilltop experience, but it's for here and now, because it goes right into the next line where he says that Jesus is peace and Lord of all. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching by peace by Jesus Christ. Jesus is the Lord of all. It's something for us here and now. Grace, joy, peace, are your birthrights in Christ. We're all entitled to have them, and we should have them. And Peter says that this didn't just come by some snapping of the fingers. This didn't just come because somebody lifted their voice and said something. It came because Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, something we will not understand this side of heaven, that Jesus was given the power of the Holy Spirit on earth. He needed the Holy Spirit. Now, what does that tell you and me? It is a magnificent gift of advice and wisdom that you cannot do anything powerful in your life whatsoever without the Holy Spirit. You can't raise your children. You can't take care of your elderly parents. You can't work your job and do it in a way that glorifies God and blesses the people around you without God's Holy Spirit. So what do? You pray, Holy Spirit of God, come into my heart and help me to be this robust person I might be to glorify you and love the people around me. Left to myself without the Holy Spirit, I'd be a wreck. I'd be a mean, difficult person. We all would be difficult. But with the Holy Spirit, he's saying you can conquer anything, even what Jesus did. And Jesus even conquered, he says in the next line, satanic oppression, evil of the world. If we think that we can encounter the evil of the world of our own strength, we're going down to defeat. It will overwhelm you. It will just crush you. Just read the newspapers and what people do to each other and say to each other, the careers that are ruined, the reputations that are tarnished, all the things that happen to people, the fortunes that are squandered. But when we are with the power of the Holy Spirit, we can be protected. Not that those things won't happen, but that we won't ultimately care if they happen, because we know we have the prize in Jesus Christ for eternal life. And there's the mindset, there's the kingdom thinking as a people who we need to be. Then he makes an important transition. Peter makes a big transition here that we have to get. After he establishes the case that it's for all of us, after he establishes that Jesus is Lord of all, after he establishes all these many things about the Holy Spirit, he says, get this. I who write this, and all those guys and women who are with me, we witnessed it. We saw it. Now you might say, well, where does that go when you see it? Why is that so important that he saw it all? Well, not just to give some affirmation of who he is and his credentials for writing the words of the Bible that he wrote, but also because it helps us to understand the absolute truths we need to understand and know that they're not in any way spurious. They are 100% reliable. He says, in essence, that Jesus truly died and was raised again. And here's how he says it. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. The tree is a reference to the cross. That's also an Old Testament prophecy that he was bringing forth. He obviously knew that. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear. So his death and physical resurrection are not to be denied. I tell you this over and over again. Don't ever let anybody in your life tell you that Jesus Christ never rose from the dead. He rose from the dead physically. And if somebody says it's not a physical manifestation, don't buy into that. Because if Jesus did not physically rise from the dead, the whole enterprise is done. We are nothing more than a philosophy. We become these people who are believing something that sounds good and we should be nice to each other. When in fact, we have conquered death and the grave through Christ. That's the enormous nature of our faith. That is what makes us special, is that we have that to hold on to. If Jesus did not raise from the dead, as I've said so many times, then take me to the nearest synagogue. Let me go and be a Jewish person and wait for the real Messiah, because he was obviously a phony. But he wasn't a phony. He rose from the dead. He walked on this earth. And Peter goes on to say, he appeared to his ragtag group. Not big shots, but to his ragtag group. Not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses. And then we get to a real big part. Peter says he ate and drank with them, and he rose from the dead. Well, this idea of eating and drinking and rising from the dead makes it clear it was a physical resurrection. But believing in the resurrection is hard for some people. And when you find the improbable people believing it, you begin to understand things. Some of you are too young to remember, many of you remember very well, that Chuck Colson, was an advisor to President Nixon. And he was one of the most powerful men in the United States, working in the White House every day, when he went down at Watergate. All the kind of scandals that happened in Watergate brought him down, and he went to prison with a bunch of people. But it was good that he went to prison, not because he just needed to be punished, but he found his faith in prison. He turned around, he came out, he started preaching, writing books, and helping people by what he found. And this is what he wrote about the resurrection, and why he knew it was true, and why he became a Christian. He said, I know the resurrection is a fact, and Watergate proved it to me. How, he asks? Because 12 men, 12 disciples, testified they had seen Jesus raised from the dead, and they proclaimed that truth for over 40 years, never once denying it. Each one of them was either beaten, tortured, stoned, put into prison, some of them put to death, in fact, of course. They would not have endured that if it wasn't true. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world. They couldn't keep alive for 3 weeks. You're telling me 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Absolutely impossible. And I give you that. No one would die for a lie. I used to practice law. I used to do criminal defense work. I represented people going to the electric chair, death penalty work, and otherwise. I spent lots and lots of time in prison. And let me tell you this. People will lie, sell out a lie. They'll say anything they have to say at any time to save their neck. They'll do anything they have to say. These apostles saw what they saw, died for it, and did not turn on the truth of what it was. And Colson raised through to them. And then finally, Peter says, with all of that, all this truth of the Holy Spirit power, of Jesus being Lord, of this being for all of us, of the resurrection being true, now he says, Jesus has commanded us to preach to the people. In other words, the next voice to enter this litany of voices is mine and yours. We're to tell the people around us in our lives, our children, our family, our friends and neighbors, of the hope that rings true within us. For they need it. They're hurting. They're lost. They're fearful. And even those of us who believe kind of lose our way, don't we? Week to week and month to month. And to hear somebody witness to it on and on makes a big difference. It is your purpose. I read a story about a Swedish au pair who had come to the United States to watch 4 children who were pretty horrific kids. And she didn't have much English. Her English was not so good. She had some English, but not as much as she needed. And the kids were absolutely going nuts. The parents were at home. They were screaming, tearing up the playroom and going crazy. And she burst into the room to yell at them and take charge. And what she meant to say to them was, what on earth are you doing? That's not how it came out. What she said to them was this, what are you doing on earth? Well, the fact of the matter is, I look at that, you know, the way my eyes work and my brain works, I'm thinking, that's a good question. What am I doing on earth? My purpose in being on earth is to glorify this God who gave me life, is to tell people the good news of Christ that's in my heart, to tell people we don't have to be afraid anymore, we're going to live forever with Jesus. These are the wonderful things that we have. Jesus, this one who loves us, will be our ultimate judge. Jesus, the one who loves us, was foretold by the prophets, says Peter. Jesus, the one who has this name, his very name means God saves. You know that the word Jesus means, if you translate it, God saves. What a perfect name for him, and that his name itself has power. So in this Epiphany season, we are told in the first week we are to have eyes to see that Jesus is God. And this week we come along and we're told we are to have ears to hear that Jesus is God. And also by Peter, that he has commanded us to go and use our voices to tell the world about all these things, especially those we love, I suppose. That's a big assignment. So that's why I said, ask the Holy Spirit to help you. Amen.